Acts chapter 1, we're going to begin reading in verse 4, make our way to verse 8, and then we're going to flip to Acts chapter 19. This is something that I felt the Lord really drop in my spirit this morning as I was getting ready for the morning message. And I mentioned it this morning. We really didn't dive into it that much, but something I felt the Lord drop on my heart this morning. Acts chapter 1, beginning in verse 4. And being assembled together with them, commanded them, this is speaking of Jesus was being assembled together with them, the disciples, commanded them that they should not depart from Jerusalem, but wait for the promise of the Father, which, saith he, you have heard of me. For John truly baptized with water, but you shall be baptized with the Holy Ghost not many days hence. And when they therefore were come together, they asked of him, saying, Lord, will you at this time restore again the kingdom to Israel? And he said unto them, It is not for you to know the times or the seasons which the Father has put in his own power. And verse 8 is where I want to draw your attention tonight. But you shall receive power after that the Holy Ghost has come upon you. And you shall be witnesses unto me, both in Jerusalem and all Judea and Samaria unto the uttermost parts of the earth. I want to read verse 8 one more time. But you shall receive power after that the Holy Ghost has come upon you, and you shall be witnesses unto me. Turn with me to Acts chapter 19. We referenced this morning when we were giving our background regarding Epaphras possibly being one of those who were assembled here in Ephesus in Acts chapter 19. Acts chapter 19, we'll begin reading in verse 1. And it came to pass that while Apollos was at Corinth, Acts 19 and verse 1, Paul, having passed through the upper coast, came to Ephesus. And finding certain disciples, he said unto them, Have you received the Holy Ghost since you believed? And they said unto Paul, We have not so much as heard whether there be any Holy Ghost. And he said unto them, Unto what then were you baptized? And they said, Unto John's baptism. We spoke about that this morning. Then said Paul, John verily baptized with the baptism of repentance, saying unto the people that they should believe on him which should come after him, that is, on Christ Jesus. When they heard this, they were baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus. And when Paul had laid his hands upon them, the Holy Ghost came upon them, and they spoke with tongues and prophesied, and all the men were about 12. Just, I guess it was a year or two ago, closer to 2 years, I guess it was, a few semesters ago, I took a class with Brother Lauren Larson entitled Pentecostal Distinctives, and really it was a class that literally changed my life. I can honestly say that it was probably my highlight class of being in World Evangelism Bible College, the Bible college that I attended for 3 years. It was probably, like I said, the highlight of all classes there for me personally, and I believe as well for others. In that class, we talked about the four aspects, the four main aspects of New Testament Christianity. Jesus saves, Jesus heals, Jesus baptizes with the Holy Spirit, and Jesus is coming again. And whenever we spoke of Jesus baptizes with the Holy Spirit, Brother Larson brought out the fact that Pentecostalism, of which I am a part, I do claim to be a Pentecostal because I am Spirit-filled. I am a tongue-talking believer. That's what a Pentecostal is. But being a Pentecostal, I know a lot of times when you get around church folk, or when you get around people in the world and they ask you, what are you? You know, what do you believe? I know personally, I tell them, well, I'm a blood-bought believer. I'm a believer in the Word of God. And they say, yeah, but what are you? Then I tell them, I'm a Pentecostal. And a lot of times they stray from that because I'm afraid to say tonight that there's a great majority of people who label themselves as Pentecostals who are not truly Pentecostals according to the Word of God. They've taken the title Pentecostal and they've put a twist upon it, and they've really distorted the true meaning of what it means to be Pentecostal. Being Pentecostal is not just about us speaking in tongues, even though that is the evidence, that is the initial physical evidence of one being baptized with the Holy Spirit. Even though that's great, even though that does encourage us, it strengthens our faith, that's not all what being Pentecostal is all about. Being Pentecostal is living a life that is Spirit-led, that is Spirit-empowered, that is Spirit-controlled, that is Spirit-driven. Everything about your life from the time you wake up to the time you go to sleep, being led, being guided by the power of the Holy Spirit. It's so much more than a preacher just simply standing up and speaking in tongues. It's so much more than running and dancing. And hey, when the Spirit of God moves upon me in that way, I'll be the first one to run. I'll be the first one to shout. You know, I'll be the first one to dance. And you know, because I love praising the Lord. And when the Spirit of God moves on my heart to do so, that's what I'm going to do. So I'm not knocking that. But what I'm telling you tonight is that's not all what Pentecostalism is about. Being a Pentecostal, being a Spirit-filled believer, is being someone who, like we said, is Spirit-empowered, Spirit-driven, Spirit-led, Spirit-guided. That's what being a Pentecostal is. It's so much more than just speaking with others. It's so much more than just, like I said, dancing and shouting. Now, I want to hammer this home to you tonight, because I know that in the church, in the time and hour in which we live, there's a major misperception on what it means to truly be a Pentecostal. And I'm afraid many of us who claim the title of being a Pentecostal, I'm afraid many of us are ignorant of what we have through the power of the Holy Spirit. What we have, what has been given to us through our salvation and through the baptism with the Holy Spirit. And I want to preach a message or teach a message tonight just entitled The Need or the Purpose for the Baptism with the Holy Spirit. And we're going to try to just break this down for us to understand in a greater way. And we'll ask the Lord for His help tonight, if you would pray with me. Heavenly Father, we come before You tonight, and we do so in the name of Your Son, Jesus Christ. Father, we thank You once again, Lord, that You've given us this privilege and this opportunity to stand before these Your people. Lord, it's always a privilege and an honor, Lord God. And Lord, I don't take it lightly. Lord, I know that in and of myself, without Your Spirit, without Your anointing, and without Your power, that, Lord, I have nothing to offer these people. Lord, You've proven that to me time and time again, Lord God. And Lord, I simply tonight, I ask for Your help, Lord God. I ask for Your anointing, Lord. It's the anointing, Lord. It's the power of the Holy Spirit that makes preaching, that makes teaching easy, Lord God, that causes people, Lord, to know Jesus in a greater light, to know Jesus in a greater way. And that's what we desire tonight. That's what we ask, Lord. Whether it be someone sitting in the sanctuary tonight or someone who will watch, Lord, by recorded device at a later date, Lord, whoever it might be, I'm asking for someone to be encouraged, to be strengthened, that somebody, Lord, would receive this great gift that You've promised us, the gift of the Holy Spirit. And we'll be sure when it's all said and done, as we do now, to give You the praise and honor and glory. In Jesus' name we pray. And everyone said amen. Yes. And amen. This morning we talked about, out of the book of Colossians, leading up to the crux of our subject this morning, we talked about the great salvation that we have in the Lord Jesus Christ. We talked about how that the gospel in Colossians chapter 1, it's the gospel that brings forth fruit in our hearts and in our lives. We talked about how that the gospel reveals to us the wisdom and the mystery of the gospel. The gospel reveals to us the knowledge and the will of Almighty God. We talked about how that through the blood of the cross of the Lord Jesus Christ, how that through that event, through that person and that event, how that Jesus Christ made peace for us with the Father, that we were alienated, we were strangers, we were enemies of God, but through the blood of Jesus' cross, through the blood, through the work of Calvary, He brought us and He reconciled us back to God. We talked about how that in Colossians chapter 2, how that you and I as believers, how that we are complete in the Lord Jesus Christ. If we have said yes to Jesus, if we have accepted Jesus as our Lord and as our Savior, we are now declared complete. There's nothing lacking. There's nothing that we need that is found outside of the Lord Jesus Christ. Everything that we have need of has been given to us the very moment that we said yes to Jesus, be it salvation, be it healing, be it deliverance. Whatever we have need of was given to us whenever we said yes to the Lord Jesus Christ. So tonight what I want to get across is the fact that we're not knocking the salvation experience, because the initial salvation experience is so powerful, it's so astounding that it literally beggars description, that I cannot, there's no preacher that's walking this earth today that can stand behind this pulpit and declare unto you how marvelous and how great your salvation is. Amen? There's no preacher who could properly orate, who could properly put into words how great the salvation is that we have in the Lord Jesus Christ, how great that efficacious and vicarious work of Calvary's cross, how great that it really was on behalf of mankind. There's no one who can truly exasperate the truths, the mighty knowledge, the mighty mysteries, the mighty gifts that are in the salvation experience of the Christian, the born-again believer. There's no one that can truly tell it all, truly explain it all. But we can all rejoice about it. We can talk about it. We'll never really know the fullness of it, but we can rejoice in what we do know. We can talk about what we do know. We can sing about what we do know. And in the book of Acts, Paul would come in Acts chapter 19, in the text we're talking about tonight, Paul would come to these believers at Ephesus and he would pose the question. He would say, "Have you received the Holy Spirit? Have you been baptized with the Holy Spirit since you believed?" These were born again believers. They had heard John the Baptist preach the gospel. They had heard John the Baptist. They were baptized unto John's repentance. They had most likely watched John the Baptist point to the Lamb of God, Jesus Christ. They had most likely watched John on the bank of the Jordan River point to Jesus Christ and say, "This is He. This is the Lamb of God. Behold the Lamb of God who comes to take away the sin of the world." They had been saved. They had received forgiveness. They had received reconciliation. They had received redemption. They were saved by the blood of Jesus. They had believed God for their salvation. But they had not yet been baptized with the Holy Spirit. In Christianity, there are three baptisms that we should and we ought to become very familiar with. The first baptism is really the most important baptism, and that's the baptism that took place whenever we said yes to Jesus. Romans chapter 6, whenever you said yes to Jesus, whenever Jesus Christ came into your heart and into your life, God the Father, God the Holy Spirit literally plucked you up, like we talked about this morning, out of the kingdom of darkness and placed you into the kingdom of His dear Son. Romans chapter 6, He baptized you into the death of the Lord Jesus Christ. He baptized you into the burial of the Lord Jesus Christ. And then you were also baptized into the newness, into the resurrection of the Lord. It's a spiritual baptism. It's not water baptism. Spiritual baptism, being baptized into Christ, is nothing that we do outwardly. It's nothing that we can see with our own eyes. It's something, it's a work of the heart. It's a work of the Holy Spirit that takes place in each individual heart and each individual life. It's nothing that you can see with the physical eye. Now the results you can see with the physical eye. The results of that baptism, because fruit is going to begin to be born, produced in your heart and your life. You're not going to, like we talked about this morning, you're not going to go the places you used to go, say the things you used to say, do the things you used to do. There's going to be a change because you've been baptized into the Lord Jesus Christ. When I said yes to Jesus, God the Holy Spirit baptized me into Jesus. So now when God looks at me, He no longer sees the sinner that I used to be, but He sees His Son. He sees the purity and the righteousness of the Lord Jesus Christ. That's what God sees when He looks at you and I tonight. And then the second baptism is water baptism. You can see it all throughout really the book of Acts and even in the Gospels. And water baptism does not save an individual. Water baptism was not given for someone to be saved. Water baptism was given for those who had been saved. You're saved by simply saying yes to the Lord Jesus Christ. You're saved by asking God to forgive you of your sins. You're saved by accepting the blood that Jesus shed at Calvary's cross. But as a result of that, Jesus commanded his disciples in Mark chapter 16 to go out into all the world, preach the gospel, and baptize people in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Water baptism is simply an outward sign of what's truly happened on the inside and the heart of an individual. That's what water baptism is. So if you've been saved by the blood of Jesus, if you have said yes to the Lord Jesus Christ, then you need to be water baptized. It's not something that saves you, but it honors God. It shows the world that I'm not what I used to be. It shows the world that I'm not where, I'm no longer in the places, I'm not no longer doing the thing. I'm a new creation in Christ Jesus. It's a testimony to the world. It's a testimony to fellow brothers and sisters that, hey, there's been a change in my heart. There's been a change in my life. And like I said, it's simply a symbol of what happened to us when we said yes to Jesus. Because as we go down in the water, it symbolizes the old man going down into the tomb. And whenever we come back up, it symbolizes us coming back up out of the water, out of the tomb, as a new creation in Christ Jesus, having a life that's not our own. It's no longer living for me. It's no longer about me, but now I'm bought with a price. Now I'm not my own. Now I'm a new creation, and the faith that I live by now is really not even a faith that's my own. It's a faith that has been given to me by God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. We're new creations in Christ Jesus. So there's spiritual baptism. I've been baptized into the Lord Jesus Christ. And then there's water baptism, simply a symbol of what happened to me in my spiritual baptism into Jesus when I said yes to Jesus. And the third baptism that the Bible teaches us about is the baptism with the Holy Spirit. And Jesus said in Acts chapter 1, like we read a moment ago in verse 8, he commanded his disciples to go and tarry in Jerusalem and wait for the promise of the Father. The promise of the Father was that which was spoken by the prophet Joel in Joel chapter 2, verses 28 and 29. This was the promise that the day would come when the Spirit of God, like we talked about this morning, the Spirit of God would not just have to abide around believers, on the outside of believers, but that the day would come when the Spirit of God would literally be able to dwell on the inside of those of us who have said yes to the Lord Jesus Christ. That was the promise of the Spirit. The promise of the Spirit entails salvation. The promise of the Spirit entails healing. The promise of the Spirit entails that there's coming a mighty move of God in this last day and in this last hour that we live in. Let me tell you something. The church of God, the church of the Lord Jesus Christ, we're not going out of this thing weak and beat up and dead and buried and bound up by the world and by the devil. We're going out of this thing with a shout. We're going out of this thing with power and with authority. I still believe with all of my heart that we have not yet, this world has not yet seen the greatest move of God that it has ever, that it's ever going to see. It's coming. Just around the corner, I believe we're going to see the book of Acts and even greater. I believe we're going to see sickened bodies healed by the power of God. I believe we're going to see demon-possessed people set free by the power of God. I believe we're going to see thousands upon thousands, even millions, saved by the blood of Jesus through the proclamation of the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. I still believe it. I don't back down from it. I don't shy away from it. I'm not scared to admit that I believe that. I still believe that an Azusa Street move of God is coming to this earth. And God needs a people, if we're going to be used in that time and in that hour, God needs a people who, number one, are sold out to His redemption plan. Because God only works through one thing, God only works through one method, God only works through one object, and that way, that method, and that object is Jesus Christ and Him crucified. It's the message of the cross, it's the preaching of the cross. So if you're going to be used in the mighty harvest, in the mighty outpouring of the Holy Spirit that God has instituted for this last hour and this last day, then you better jump on board and you better hold fast to the message of Jesus Christ and Him crucified. You say, well, I don't understand it. It doesn't matter. Keep on seeking Him. Like we talked about this morning, keep on looking for those things which are above. Keep on pressing toward the mark of the prize of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus. Ask God, God, give me a revelation knowledge of this message of the cross. Give it to me, Lord. Because that's what God's working through. That's what God has always worked through from the beginning of time until now, until the rapture comes. God has only worked through one thing and is only working through one thing and will only work through one thing, and that is the message of Jesus Christ and Him crucified. And the Bible, like we said, talks about a third baptism. A baptism with the Holy Spirit. A baptism that has been given to believers for power. As he talked about, like in our scripture tonight, Acts chapter 1 and verse 8, the power of the Holy Spirit has been given to us to endue us with power from on high so that we can be witnesses unto the world. When you said yes to Jesus, the Holy Spirit came into your heart to take up residence. He came into your heart to live and to abide with you, Jesus said, until the ends of the earth. Unless you turn away from Him, and still He's going to try to draw you back to Himself. But Jesus said, lo, I will be with you even unto the ends of the earth. So when you said yes to Jesus, the presence, the person of the Holy Spirit, the third member of the triune Godhead, came into your heart and took up residence. But there's a second subsequent work of grace, as we're talking about tonight, called the baptism with the Holy Spirit, where it's not the Spirit baptizing you into Jesus, but now it's Jesus immersing you and baptizing you into the person of the Holy Spirit. Before we go any further tonight, we need to know that being baptized with the Holy Spirit, speaking in tongues, has never saved anyone. You're saved by simply saying yes to Jesus. But I believe what the baptism of the Holy Spirit is given to us for, of course, it's to endue us with power, but it's to make Jesus real in our hearts and in our lives. I heard one definition of the word revival is to make Jesus real, to enhance the person and the work of the Lord Jesus Christ. And in Acts chapter 1 and verse 8, Jesus would tell us to go and tarry in Jerusalem. He would tell his disciples, go and tarry in Jerusalem, that you might be filled with the Holy Ghost. That after the Holy Ghost has come upon you, you shall be witnesses unto me. There are four types of witnesses, as I learned about a few years ago, and I've studied it and I believe it, that there are four types of witnesses that are addressed here in this passage. Number one, of course, is the verbal witness. It's the witness that gives me the power, that gives me the ability to preach the gospel with boldness, to preach the gospel without fear of contradiction, to preach the gospel without fear of what someone's going to say, to preach the gospel with an anointing, to preach the gospel with power so that someone else can hear the great redemption plan of the Lord Jesus Christ. Because that's what this thing's all about, isn't it? We're to be lights in a darkened world. We're to be salt of a dying earth, a filthy earth. That's what we're called to be. We're called to be salt and we're called to be light. But we cannot do that in and of ourselves. We cannot properly witness. We cannot properly preach the gospel. We cannot properly tell people about Jesus without the help and without the unction and the power of the Holy Spirit. The Bible tells me that it's the Spirit of God that draws men unto Jesus. It's not man who draws men to Jesus. God will use men to be unctioned and anointed by His Spirit. But truly, if anybody is saved, if anybody is touched by God, if anybody was ever healed by God, if anybody ever received anything from God, it was through the power of the Holy Spirit. The verbal witness. To be a witness, it includes an anointed verbal presentation. Some examples of this you can find in 1 Corinthians chapter 12, 1 Corinthians chapter 14, where Paul would talk about the gifts of the Spirit. The gifts of the Spirit, which are given by the Holy Spirit, they're simply gifts, nothing that we earn, nothing that we can take from God in and of ourselves. They're gifts from God. The gifts of the Spirit are given to edify the body. That's what the gifts of the Spirit are for. They're given to edify the body. It's not to build you up. It's not to make you look like some paragon of righteousness. It's not to make you look like some great man of God so that everybody can adore you and think that you're the best thing in the world. No, the gifts of the Spirit that come by receiving the baptism with the Holy Spirit, the gifts of the Spirit are given to edify, to strengthen, to encourage, to build up the body of Christ. Some examples of these are the word of wisdom, a word of knowledge, the gift of prophecy, the gift of tongues, the gift of the interpretation of tongues, prophecy. Simply when God speaks to His people through a vessel, when God speaks, sometimes in services, God will speak through a word of prophecy. Someone will stand up and begin to speak under the anointing and the unction of the Holy Spirit. Someone in the congregation, a pastor, a musician, it really doesn't matter who it is. Begin to speak, the oracles begin to speak the great things of God, and prophecy will always point you in some way, shape, or form, to the Lamb of God, the Lord Jesus Christ. The gift of tongues, this is separate from really the tongues that we receive when we receive the baptism with the Holy Spirit, but really it's a gift of diverse tongues. There are some people who they've been baptized in the Holy Spirit for several years and they've spoken a very similar language the whole time. It's a language, of course, that they do not know, but it's very similar. But there are some people, and I know a couple of them personally, that, man, I've heard them speak in tongues several times, and every time it's a completely different language. It's the gift of diverse tongues is what it is. The gift of the interpretation of tongues. In services at times, when God chooses to speak by word of prophecy, sometimes He'll choose to speak by the method of a message in tongues. You hear someone stand up and give an utterance in another tongue that no one knows. And then another person across the congregation, or that same person, will then have the gift of the interpretation of tongues. They will stand up under the anointing of the Holy Spirit and begin to interpret that which was spoken through the message in tongues. Acts chapter 4 gives us another portrayal, Acts chapter 4, verse 29, of the verbal witness, the powerful verbal witness of the Holy Spirit. This was when the early church, they were being persecuted. They began to be imprisoned. They began to be taken before councils and even beaten. Peter and John were beaten. And in Acts chapter 4, verse 29, and now this is what the disciples said, "And now, Lord, behold their threatenings. And grant unto your servants that with all boldness they may speak your word, by stretching forth your hand to heal, and that signs and wonders might be done by the name of your holy child Jesus." And when they had prayed, the place was shaken where they were assembled together. And they were all filled with the Holy Ghost, and they spake the word of God with boldness. So this is a verbal witness. It's a powerful, anointed witness that comes from our mouth when we speak to people. That when we speak to people, they can sense and feel the anointing of the Holy Spirit, that they know that there's something different about you, like we talked about this morning. I don't want to be just someone who, claims this, that, and the other, but I want people to sense and to feel the anointing of God upon my life. I want people to know that the Spirit of God is residing within me, that the Spirit of God is anointing me to speak, because it's only the Spirit that can draw men to Jesus. I can speak to somebody all day. I can give them all the Scripture, all the theological greats of the Bible. I can tell all of those things. But if I don't have the anointing and the unction of the Holy Spirit, if I don't have the Holy Spirit leading me and guiding me to do so, then my preaching and my teaching is in vain. If I don't have the power of the Holy Spirit leading my words and guiding my words, then they won't be drawn to Jesus. We need the anointing of the Holy Spirit. The second witness that is involved in this witness addressed in Acts 1 and 8 is the lifestyle witness. Us as Pentecostals, we should be literally those of us who claim to be Spirit-filled, those of us who claim to speak with other tongues, we should be the most church-going, the most Bible-reading, the most singing people in the world. We should be people who are portraying the life of the Lord Jesus Christ. We should be a people in whom the life of Christ is being manifested on a day-to-day, hour-to-hour, minute-to-minute basis. It's the lifestyle witness. That which is coming out from my mouth should be lining up with the way that my life is being lived. We talked about that this morning. That my life should be lining up to the things that I speak, the things that I say, the songs that I sing. That my life should be portraying that. If I'm talking about the Lord Jesus Christ, then I need to be portraying. My life needs to be manifesting the life and the power of the Lord Jesus Christ. Can this happen without the baptism with the Holy Spirit? Yes, it can. I know people who aren't baptized with the Holy Spirit yet. They're seeking the baptism with the Holy Spirit. They are. They're pursuing after the baptism with the Holy Spirit. I know one individual who sought after the baptism for, it was 7 to 10 years. She was desiring and trying to be baptized, wanting the baptism with the Holy Spirit. Was she not a Christian? No, she was a born-again believer. She loved God. She was a witness of God. She told people about Jesus. Her life was being led and guided by the Spirit, but by her own testimony, she could stand here tonight and tell you that whenever she was baptized with the Holy Spirit, it was enhanced to such a greater degree. So many people in the church who claim the title Pentecostal, they have used the baptism in the Holy Spirit to say that if you're not baptized with the Holy Spirit like I am, then you're just not as good as I am. You just don't have it like I got it. That's foolishness. Don't think that I'm up here saying that tonight, because that's not what I'm trying to portray. Because there's no such thing as a second-class Christian. If you're saved by the blood of Jesus, it doesn't matter who you are, where you're from, you're just as righteous, just as holy, just as saved in the eyes of God as the greatest preacher of the gospel who's ever lived, who's ever walked this earth. There's no such thing as a second-class citizen in the kingdom of God. If you're an heir, then you're an heir. You being an heir of God and a joint heir with the Lord Jesus Christ, it's not based upon your condition. It's not based upon this, that, and the other. It's based on your acceptance of the Lord Jesus Christ. There's no such thing as a second-class Christian. So for those preachers who are going about saying that and condemning people, saying that you have to speak in tongues to be saved, that's a false message. It's a false gospel. They're condemning people. Really, they're discouraging people because people are seeking after the baptism with the Holy Spirit, and it might take them longer than some other people, and they're being told that they're not saved because they don't have it. That's foolishness. That's a false gospel. That's deception. That's a wrong way. No, what I want to tell you tonight, what I want to encourage you, is to seek after the baptism with the Holy Spirit, not to get saved, because if you've said yes to Jesus, you're already saved. But I want to encourage you to seek after the baptism with the Holy Spirit, because the baptism with the Holy Spirit, the person of the Holy Spirit being immersed into Him, makes Jesus so much more real in your heart and in your life. It enhances the person and the work of the Lord Jesus Christ. You then have help to become a lifestyle witness. You have greater help than you had before, because you're not just doing this thing all by yourself. Because now when you're baptized with the Spirit, you don't just have the Holy Spirit living on the inside of you, but Jesus has literally placed you in to the person of the Holy Spirit. So now you can be led, you can be empowered, you can be guided on a day-to-day, hour-to-hour, minute-to-minute basis by the power of the Holy Ghost. That's the point of this message tonight. It's not to discourage anyone. It's to encourage whoever you may be. And there's some of us who we've received the baptism with the Holy Spirit, but we need a fresh touch from heaven. We need to be refilled with the Holy Spirit. We need to be rebaptized with the Holy Spirit. It's a continual filling with the Holy Spirit. It's not just, okay, I was filled one time and that's it. No, I need to be filled with the power of God. I need to be baptized into the person of the Holy Spirit. Every single day that I live, I need the power of Almighty God. Amen. If we're going to make it in this last hour, in this last day, I'm talking about a lifestyle witness. If they come to me and say, hey, I'm going to take you to the chopping block in just a few moments unless you denounce Jesus, that's something I can't do in and of my own power. If they came to my house right now and said, hey, you're a Christian, and I said, yeah, okay, well, we're going to cut your head off like we did the disciples, I don't know what I would do. But I pray that the power of the Holy Spirit would anoint me to say, okay, do what you want to do, because I know where I'm going. I know what's going on in my life. I know I'm saved by the blood of Jesus. I know that I've been bought with the price. And I pray to God that He would allow that lifestyle witness to empower me to say, it doesn't matter what you do to me. It doesn't matter what you say about me. I'm still going to portray. I'm still going to walk as Jesus would have me to walk.
Amen.
This walk that we talked about this morning, pursuing after righteousness and pursuing after holiness, you need as much help as you can get.
Amen.
This thing isn't easy. I don't stand up here tonight declaring unto you that living the life of a Christian, that living Christianity is an easy thing. It's an easy thing in the sense that God has made it simple for mankind, and that all He requires of mankind is that we place our faith continually in Christ and what He's done at the cross. And through me doing that, He then supplies to me the power of the Spirit that is needed to live for Him. He then supplies to me this power of the Holy Spirit that is needed. He's made it simple. But at times it's not easy. It's a fight to believe what we believe. Why? Because we're simply a remnant in the earth and the time and hour in which we live. When the church of God, they've strayed away from the truth of the gospel. The church of God, they've strayed away from preaching the purity, the doctrine of the Lord Jesus Christ. They've strayed away. It's not easy whenever all of hell, all of the world, and even now all of the church is coming against those of us who believe the message of Jesus Christ and Him crucified. Those of us who refuse to go back into the world. Those of us who refuse to allow worldly music in our churches. Those of us who refuse to allow false doctrines in our churches. They don't like us. It was the religious folk of Jesus' day that crucified Him. It was not the world. It was not those who were bound by sin and did not know anything about God. No, it was those who had a knowledge of God, but it was not the knowledge that God required.
Amen.
They claimed they had a knowledge of God. They had a knowledge of the law, but the knowledge that they had puffed them up rather than bring them to Jesus. Because Jesus looked at them and told them, "You search the Scriptures, for in them you think that you have life, but yet you refuse to come to me, the one whom the Scripture talks about, the one whom the Scripture points to." It was the religious folks who persecuted Jesus, the religious folks who persecuted Paul. In every city that he went to, the Judaizers following behind Paul, those who claim to know Jesus, those who claim to know the oracles and the law of God, would follow Paul and they would persecute him. That's what we're up against in the time and hour in which we live. That's why we need all the help that we can get, not from our fellow brothers and sisters, but from God Himself. Because let me tell you something, sometimes your brother is going to fail. Sometimes your sister is going to fail. You need more than just a hand of flesh. You need more than just the arm of flesh. You need the everlasting arms of the Lord Jesus Christ. You need the power of the Holy Ghost. We've got to have the power and the anointing of the Holy Ghost in the time and in the hour in which we live. Jeremiah said in Jeremiah chapter 17, my friend John Collier preached on a wonderful message just a few Sundays ago, leaning on the everlasting arms. Jeremiah chapter 17, Jeremiah would say, "Cursed be the man that trusteth in man and makes the arm of flesh his strength." Cursed is that man. If you're leaning upon your preacher, if you're leaning upon your brother and your sister in order to walk right before God, in order to be holy before God, in order to do this thing before God, if you're leaning upon them, then you don't have the help of God.
Amen.
You've got to rely upon what God has provided for you. And what God has provided for you is the promise of the Holy Spirit, the power of the Holy Spirit to aid you, to help you, to give you strength, to give you encouragement, to give you power to live this life as a Christian. I'm talking about the lifestyle witness. I'm talking about living for God. I'm talking about pursuing after the call of God. I'm talking about pursuing after the will of God. Something you cannot do in and of yourself. Go ahead and try. Go ahead and try. You're going to fail every single time. How do you know, preacher? Because I've been there. And still at times I find myself there trying within my own power to speak for God, trying within my own power to live a lifestyle that portrays the image of the Lord Jesus Christ, trying to do it in and of my own power. And I can do it for a little while, but then eventually I'll just fall flat on my face and I find myself where I started. And then I'll try it a little more and I fall flat on my face. Try it a little more, fall flat, make a fool of myself. Make a mess of things, make a fool of myself, make a fool of people, make people look bad, make myself look bad. It's because we rely upon ourselves too much. We talked about it this morning, Luke 9 and 23, where Jesus commanded his disciples, deny yourself, take up the cross and follow after me. The third witness is a supernatural witness. So we have the verbal witness. We have the anointed verbal witness. We have number two, the lifestyle witness. And number three, we have the supernatural witness. The witness, the power that gives us the power to work miracles. Gives us the power to be anointed by the Holy Spirit. Gives us the power to lay hands on the sick and watch them recover. Gives us the power to walk up to those who are demon-possessed and cast out those devils in the name of Jesus. Gives us the power, Mark 16 says, to tread on serpents and they won't hurt us. Gives us the power to do what God is asking us to do as it regards ministering and working for Him. Hebrews chapter 2 and verse 4. Hebrews 2 and 4. The Bible says, God also bearing them witness, both with signs and wonders, and with diverse miracles and gifts of the Holy Ghost. It's the supernatural witness. If in this last day if we're going to be used in the realm of healing, if we're going to be used in the realm of miracles and gifts and so on and so forth, we need the power of the Holy Spirit. We've got to have the power of the Holy Spirit anointing our hands to lay hands on the sick. You can't heal somebody in and of your own power. You can't cast out a devil in and of your own power. You can see that in the book of Acts. Actually, in Acts chapter 19, the seven sons of Sceva, they came to this demon-possessed man. Seven grown men came to this man who was demon-possessed and said, hey, we adjure you in the name of Jesus, whom Paul preaches, and who Apollos preaches, and who we, in the name of the one that they all preach, we adjure you that you come out of this man. See, they didn't have a revelation of Christ for themselves. This is a personal walk, people. This is not, you can't live off of somebody else's relationship with God.
Amen.
You cannot live off of somebody else being filled with the Holy Spirit. You cannot live off of somebody else being led and empowered by the Holy Spirit. You have got to have it for yourself.
Amen.
You've got to have it for yourself. And whenever they came to this man, one man demon-possessed, they said what they said, and the demon spoke back to them and said, hey, yeah, Paul I know and Jesus I know, but who in the world are you? He didn't know who they were because they were not walking in the power of the Holy Spirit. They were trying to walk in another man's revelation, trying to walk in another man's power. This is personal. Not your neighbor, yes, they need the power of the Holy Spirit, but you need the power of the Holy Spirit. I'm talking to me tonight. I'm talking to you as an individual. Don't sit there and think, well, so-and-so needs the baptism. This one needs... No, you need the power of Almighty God moving and operating in your heart and in your life. We've got to have it. I need a refilling of the Holy Spirit. I need a continual refreshing and continual river of the Holy Spirit moving and operating in my heart and in my life. And in this chapter, Acts 19, that we were in just a moment ago, the Bible says that we talked about it this morning as well, in verse 11, how that God wrought special, unusual, that word special there means unusual miracles, by the hands of the Apostle Paul. We talk about, man, I'm ready to see healing, I'm ready to see deliverance, I'm ready to see all these things. It's only going to come about by the power of the Holy Spirit. I don't know about you, but I want to be used in this great harvest that's about to take place. I want to be used to heal the sick. I want to be used to cast out devils. I want to be used to preach the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. And it only comes by the power of the Holy Spirit. The same power that Jesus walked in when he was upon this earth is the same power that you and I have an availability to. Jesus walked this earth as God, but as a man. He was God, but he walked this earth as a man, empowered by the Holy Spirit. How do I know that? Matthew chapter 3, when Jesus was baptized. Matthew chapter 3 and chapter 4. John baptized Jesus into the river Jordan. And when he came up out of the water, the Bible says that the Spirit descended upon Jesus as a dove. Jesus then received the baptism with the Holy Spirit. He received the Spirit of God from on high to then equip him to do what God had called him to do in this. So look at the miracles. John said in the last chapter of John, John 21, John said in the very last verse that if all the things that Jesus did on this earth, if they were recorded in a book, he said literally there would not be enough books in the world to contain the miracles and the mighty things that were wrought by the hand of Jesus. What we read in the scriptures in Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John were just a few. There were just a few stories, a few miraculous stories of what Jesus did. Opening the eyes of blind Bartimaeus. Healing the lame. Healing those who were bound by leprosy. Leprosy, a disease so vile that your limbs, your extremities, they would fall off one by one. Fingers would literally rot on your corpse and fall off. Noses would literally rot and they would turn black and then fall off of your face. Leprosy, such a horrible and wicked disease. But yet the leper came to Jesus and said, Jesus, if you will, you can make me whole. You can't only heal me, but you can make me whole. Jesus didn't just heal him and cause the disease to stop, but he healed him and he restored unto him everything that disease had taken from him. That's power. I'm talking about fingers growing back on their hands, noses growing back on their faces, literally before the eyes of people. That's power. And that same power that Jesus had to perform those miracles, to walk in that anointing and that power, it's available to you and I tonight. Are we God? No, I'm not saying we're God. I'm saying we're man. We're men and women who can be empowered, led, guided, anointed by the Spirit of Almighty God. That's why we need, that's the purpose for the baptism with the Holy Spirit. It's to be a verbal witness. It's to be a lifestyle witness. It's to be a supernatural witness that we can that we can work miracles in these last days, in this last hour in which we live. And number four, you might kind of laugh at this one, but I'll explain myself, so don't shrug it off too fast. But the last one is a dying witness. When Jesus said, you shall be witnesses unto me. That word witness in the Greek is literally the word martyr. It's the Greek word for martyr, where we get our word martyr. So, first and foremost, Jesus was telling them, I'm going to give you power that if they come to you and say we're going to kill you, then you're going to be a testimony in your death. that as they take your life, I'm going to give you power to even go to death for me if that's what it takes. And all the apostles, really, except for John, faced that type of death, martyrdom. Peter, it is supposed that Peter, historians say, was crucified upside down. It is supposed, well, it's not supposed, it's true that the Apostle Paul was laid on a guillotine. He had his head cut from his body. And all of the disciples, all of the apostles had to go through this type of persecution, this type of martyrdom. But there's a greater death, I believe, and we talked about this in Pentecostal distinctives, that there's a greater death that God wants you and I to personally die. And that is the death to self. That is the death to self. In Matthew chapter 3, verse 11 and 12, Jesus said, or John the Baptist said, I indeed baptize you with water into repentance. But he that cometh after me is mightier than I, whose shoes I am not worthy to bear. He shall baptize you with the Holy Ghost and with fire, whose fan is in his hand, and he will thoroughly purge his floor and gather his wheat into the garner. But he will burn up the chaff with unquenchable fire. Now, John the Baptist here is talking about what's going to take place in the lives of those who accept this one who is to come. When John the Baptist talks about the Messiah burning up chaff with unquenchable fire, he's not talking about sinners. He's not talking about those who are lost and never accepted the Lord Jesus Christ and God destroying them with fire. No, he's talking about those of us who have come to Jesus. Whenever we come to Jesus and we say yes to Jesus, like we talked about this morning, we enter the process that we know as sanctification. We enter the process that we know as living for God, walking for God, pursuing after the righteousness of God. But there's things, even after I say yes to Jesus, there's things in my heart and in my life that are not pleasing to God. There are things that I think that are not pleasing to God. There are things that I say that are not pleasing to God. There are places that I go that are still not pleasing to God. I'm talking about born again, spirit-filled believers. There's things in your life tonight, whether you realize it or not, whether you want to admit it tonight, that's between you and the Lord, but I can tell you it's true. There's things in your heart and things in your life tonight that God is going to have to change, that God is going to have to pull out of you, that God is going to have to remove from your heart and from your life. And can I testify to you tonight that the process of sanctification, the process of God ripping out of me what needs not be there and placing into me what needs to be there, it's not an easy process. When God, by the power of the Holy Spirit, comes and convicts me of things in my life that I'm not supposed to be doing, ways that I shouldn't be thinking, things that I shouldn't be saying, I don't immediately have a Pentecostal fit and say, oh, glory to God. No. When God, the Holy Ghost, convicts me of those things, it breaks my heart. And sometimes it takes God a little more force than what it took him the last time to take those things out of me. God might have to bring me through a trial or two to show me that I'm not where I need to be. Read the book of Job. Job, a believer. Job, a blood-bought believer in the Lord, but yet had his household taken from him, his family, his cattle. Everything that Job had upon this earth was completely stripped from him. But you know what Job said in the midst of all of that? After all his family was taken dead, all his cattle were dead, everything was literally stripped from his life. He was sitting down in the dirt, covered in ashes and boils. His body was broken out in sores and in boils, with ashes on his head, mourning, repenting to the Lord. His wife next to him telling him, Job, just curse God and die. Just forget about God. Forget about this Lord that you claim. Forget about it. His own wife telling him, curse God and die. I mean, I can't even imagine that. But in the midst of all of that, Job was able to speak, I know that my Redeemer lives. I know that my Redeemer lives. And he would say, I know that God knows, he knows the way that I take. And I know that when he has tried me, I will come forth as pure gold. That's the dying witness that I'm talking about, is the purification of your faith. The purification of your faith does not come easy. It does not come simply. The purification of your faith, purifying, solidifying your faith in Christ and what he's done at the cross, is going to take some trials. It's going to take some tribulation. It's going to take some chastening from the Lord. And in that time, you're going to get discouraged. In that time, there are going to be times when you cry out and say, God, what are you doing to me? God, what is going on? God, why would you allow something like this to happen? God, why would you do such a thing to me? Lord, I love you. Lord, I've served you. Lord, I've been in church. I've given to the ministry. I've given my time. I've given my finances. Why am I going through what I'm going through? But Hebrews chapter 12 tells us that God chastens those he loves. That God puts us through trials and through tribulations, not because he hates us. He allows things to come upon our lives, not because he hates us, but because he loves us. Over the past several years, I've gone through some of the hardest times of my life. And in those times, of course, I was scared, I was worried, not knowing what was going to happen. But I can honestly say, and while you're in that trial, while you're in the midst of that, it seems like I would just rather die than be on this earth. I would just rather die and just go to heaven. I don't even want to be here. This is just so miserable. It's so heart-wrenching and heartbreaking, and it is. So I'm not mocking that. I'm not laughing at that, because it truly is. It's heartbreaking. It's heart-wrenching. But I can honestly look back on all the things that I've gone through. And I'm saying this tonight, and all hell will probably break loose tomorrow. But you know what? I've come to know, and I've come to believe, I've come to learn that the things that God brings me through, they're not for my destruction. They're for my strengthening. They're for my edification. They're for the purifying of my faith. In the days of Jesus, the example he would give in Matthew chapter 3, when he would say, whose fan is in his hand, and he will thoroughly purge his floor and gather his wheat into the garner, but he will burn up the chaff with unquenchable fire. The men who were farmers, who harvesters, who grew wheat in the fields, when they would go and they would harvest their wheat, they would have to bring it to what they called a threshing floor. And on this threshing floor is where they would separate the good wheat, the product that they would sell, the product that they would make things with, the product that was good. They would have to separate it from the product that was bad. They would have to separate it from what was called the chaff. So a process that they used in that day and in that hour is they would bring all of the wheat that they had gathered that day, and they would place it in a pile. Sometimes they would be upon a hillside or whatever the case, but they would place this wheat in a large pile, and they would take oxen, and the oxen would walk over this wheat over and over and over and over again, breaking it, molding it, breaking it and molding it, breaking it, and just crushing the wheat, crushing the chaff, separating the chaff from the wheat. It was a process that if you were the wheat, it would have hurt. You've got oxen walking all over you, separating. And then after the oxen would walk over that for a period of time, those farmers, they would take pitchforks, and they would grab this wheat, and they would throw it up into the air. And like I said, they would either be on a hillside where the wind was blowing really well, where a breeze was blowing really well, or they would have someone standing near with a fan, a big sheet or a big piece of cloth or leaves or whatever the case, and they would stand next to where they were throwing this wheat up into the air, and they would blow, and there was a wind that was there. And whenever they would throw the wheat into the air, the chaff was much lighter than the wheat. And they would throw the wheat up into the air, and that wind would literally take the chaff and pull it away from the wheat. So then after that process was done of them throwing wheat into the air time and time again, now you had a pile of pure wheat that you could do whatever you wanted to do with. a pile of wheat that you could cook with, sale, whatever the case was, whatever your product, well, you have a pile of it that was pure. It was no longer defiled by the chaff that was in it. And what they would do with the chaff that was separated from the wheat, they would take it and they would burn it. And that's what Jesus was talking about. That's the process that you and I have to go through. God has to, of course, He's harvested us at salvation. But now we've began the breaking process. Now we've began the process of being sanctified. We've began the process where now God, through the power of the Holy Spirit, has to begin to change things in our hearts and in our lives. He has to begin to pluck things away from us that doesn't need to be there. The chaff that was in with the wheat was good for nothing. That's why they burned it, because it was good for no one. There's things in your life right now, in your heart tonight, that's good for no one. It's not good for you, and it's not good for anyone else. Thoughts that you have, things that you say, places that, whatever it is, whatever God the Holy Spirit is working on you about right now, there's things in you that God wants to change, that God wants to root out of you. That's the process that we're in. He's trying to separate that which is good, because now we're a new creation. We now have the Spirit of God trying to bear fruit in our hearts and in our lives. So God is trying to remove the chaff from our lives. And it's a lifelong process. It's not something that's just going to happen overnight. It's not something that's just going to happen by you coming to the altar one time. It's a lifelong process of that wheat being separated from the tare, being separated from the chaff. God's trying to break you. God is trying to mold you into the image of the Lord Jesus Christ. He's trying to separate that chaff from the wheat. And it's not easy. It hurts. It feels like oxen are walking on the top of us, separating it. It feels like 1,000 pounds is upon our shoulders and we don't know what to do. We don't know where. I understand. I know what it's like. I'm not saying I've gone through everything that maybe some of you have. Maybe I don't know what you've gone through. But I can tell you that I've been through enough. Like we sing at the ministry, I've been through enough to know that He will be enough for me. I've been through enough. I know. And guess what? Like I said, tomorrow, this week, God the Holy Ghost, I know He's going to have to break me again. He's going to have to show me some things again that, hey, Ross, that's not pleasing to me. Ross, that needs to go. Ross, you've been having some thoughts I don't want you to have. You've been saying some things I don't want you to say. You've been doing some things I don't want you to do. And what is that for me? I don't know. What is it for you? You know. God knows. I'm not condemning you tonight. I'm encouraging you. That through the power of the Holy Spirit, that thing on the inside of you that you see is wrong, that you see is against God, that you see is not pleasing to God, God, through the power of His Spirit, can take that thing from you and burn it up to where you'll never see it again. That's the power of the Holy Spirit. And when you're in the midst, Sam, you can come up, when you're in the midst of these trials, when you're in the midst of this adversity, when you're in the midst of God putting you to the death of yourself, that you're not living to yourself anymore, but you're living to a new purpose. You're living unto God and His plan, God and His will. When you're in this process, it's going to hurt. You're going to need some encouragement besides just encouragement from yourself. You're going to need more encouragement than the encouragement of your brothers and sisters. As good as that is, we need that. But sometimes what they have to say just doesn't meet the need. We need the power of the Holy Spirit. If you're saved tonight, you have the indwelling presence of the Holy Spirit. But I encourage you tonight to seek after the baptism with the Holy Spirit. Because what the baptism with the Holy Spirit does, it immerses you into the person of the Holy Spirit, and it enhances. It makes Jesus so much more real to you. And the baptism with the Holy Spirit is accompanied. The evidence of it is us speaking with new tongues as the Spirit of God gives the utterance. Acts chapter 2, chapter 10, chapter 19. Speaking with other tongues as the Spirit of God gives the utterance. It's not something we have to be afraid of. I know a lot of people, what holds them back from receiving the baptism is that it scares them. They're not really sure about it. They're not really sure how to go about it, how, you know, it kind of makes them, it's nothing to be scared of. The baptism with the Holy Spirit, speaking with other tongues, it's a gift from God. It's a gift that God has given us that edifies us and strengthens us. Jude, verses 20 and 21, he would say this, "But you, beloved, build up yourselves on your most holy faith, praying in the Holy Ghost." So Jude tells us that the baptism with the Holy Ghost, praying in the Holy Ghost, praying in other tongues, that it builds us up in our most holy faith.